That's so much talking, research, but in this thing, I'm reviewing the research, the limited or whatever kind of research. As Lauren said, I'm a professor in the Department of Food and Nutritional Sciences, and I really want us to have a look at the, we are looking at it from the consumer end, what the consumers are going to get out of this whole organic situation. And of course, I'm not going to dwell on the production part of it, which I know very little about. But what we do know about as nutritionists, we know about consumers' perception of organic food. We know that it's associated with, you know, consumers assume that organic foods differ from those produced conventionally. And the value associated with this difference includes things like the premium retail price we pay. They are produced without antibiotics, without added hormones, with synthetic chemicals, and of course there is no genetic modification. Consumers also know that organic farming is kinder to the environment, kinder to animals, and also to us humans. We also know that it may have some potential benefits for human health. There is a growing body of evidence which shows that, you know, foods produced using organic methods provide higher levels of beneficial nutrients. This slide just shows some of the characteristics of organic agriculture. We know again about it has respect for environment and animals. We know that it promotes sustainable cropping methods. We know it includes the use of non-chemical fertilizers, pesticides, weed, disease control means. And we also know that it's one of the main characteristics is the production of high quality food and no use of GMO materials. In terms of the research and what we know about nutrition and organic food, we know that studies have shown differences among, you know, organic and non-organic. And a lot of the studies we are seeing is in terms of, you know, the organic growing or the organic farming. But as far as we researchers are concerned, we researchers in the field of nutrition and the science of food, the information still remains very limited for us to recall. What are some of the problems we have with the information? We have a lot of variations in organic and non-organic production methods. And as I listened to the earlier presentations, I could see and hear some of the variations. Because of these variations, a lot of differences are created, which prevent development of an effective method to test the authenticity of organic products. For us, the variations are creating problems. We have many studies comparing organic and non-organic vegetables. But again, we have a limited number of generally accepted research conclusions on the differences between organic and non-organic. I heard a lot of it this morning. We grow an organic crop this year, we don't grow it next year, we do it for 3 years, it's not consistent, we can't make a firm statement on it because it's not really consistent. What we do know is that there is need for much more research, and if we do have the research, and we're talking about long-term research, for example, if Quarko is working, for example, on squash and his pesticides. We want years of work, years of consistent work, not 2 years, not 3 years, before we could really, really define the nutritional quality. So really this morning, what I want to do in a few minutes is just to describe the nutritional quality of some organic vegetables comparative to those that are grown conventionally. And again, it's the literature we are reviewing. We heard a lot about soil health, and there was one interesting question for me, because I think the research in soil health presented by, I already forgot, but he was saying that it's conventional crops research is being done. We do know that in terms of soil health and in terms of microbes, we as nutritionists are very interested in the microbial soil transformations in terms of our nutrients. And we do know there is a difference between the organic and non-organic. So when we look at the soil microbes and nutrients in organic farming here, we could see here that, of course, they add organic matter to the soil, and for conventional farming, they do not add organic matter, so it doesn't influence the soil structure. But what is added here influences soil structure, which in turn influences nutrients. They do, in organic, we have optimal use of the microbes and natural capital of soil. In conventional farming, they rely heavily on synthetic fertilizer. What is particularly good for us as nutritionists is that in organic farming, the soil nutrients are released slowly over time. With the synthetic fertilizers or in conventional farming, the nutrients are released at once, and that is not too good for us. So let us look at some of the nutrients in some of the what they are saying about organic and non-organic. So in terms of crude protein, we know for a fact that crude protein or protein content is much lower in organic products. But if you look at the second bullet, so conventional products have higher protein content. But the protein quality we do know in organic is much better. In organic produce have a lot more of the essential amino acids. For example, lysine, and we're talking about, we have about 8 essential amino acids that our body cannot synthesize. So we do know that for sure. In terms of dry matter content, we know that leafy and root vegetables, your tubers, they have higher dry matter contents in organic foods. A lot of researchers have brought that forward. If we, for example, in tomatoes, in terms of dry matter, which we have here, we see there's no significant difference. That's from another researcher, and that's how the research is going down the road. In terms of your macronutrients, we know that data regarding the levels of your carbohydrates or starch, they are too limited. We just don't have the data. We cannot make a call on that. Minerals. This slide just shows you the most studied minerals in organic foods. They are all listed here. Calcium, potassium, zinc. I'm not going to go through the whole slide. But these are the most studied minerals in organic foods. And when we look at the nutrient, the mineral content, when we look at the minerals here in this column, we see which vegetables have which mineral. So, for example, if you look at calcium, you will see that beetroot, cabbage, carrot, kale, leek, lettuce, they are high in calcium. And you would pretty much see the same vegetables happening if we look at iron, if we look at magnesium. These are the vegetables that have a lot of that. in terms of zinc, which is one of our minerals which we have found is very useful in body performance and development. We could see the vegetables which have, we could see the vegetables which we need to work on more so for our organic production. And then this table just shows the difference in mineral content in certain organic foods. So this plus means, for example, if we look at lettuce, this is plus 117, it means that organic food has a significantly higher vitamin C content than conventionally grown lettuce. And this is all the pluses mean, that these are the organic foods or vegetables that have higher content, and you could see where it's happening. So these are your minerals here, and these are your vegetables, and the plus indicate that organic is higher. The negative, it just doesn't happen. So this is an idea of how we look in terms of the minerals. Again, this slide is just showing how they look, the percent additional mineral content in organic compared to conventional, and you could see the percentage here, of course, it's higher. So we know, or we are seeing, that we do have higher mineral contents in general in the organic food. And we look at this one, we could see these listed here, potatoes, carrots, beetroot, kale, turnip, etc. These have higher levels of iron and magnesium, and it's on a fresh weight basis. When we look at antioxidant activity, we have a number of meta-analyses out there. And this one in particular I'm citing, they analyzed over 300 studies. And to get 300 studies, they had to throw out a whole lot of studies, again, because of the variations. But they concluded that organic crops have significantly higher antioxidant levels compared to conventional crops. And of course, I have to move on. These are the antioxidants showing the relative thing. And I'm going to skip because I have 2 minutes. I am going to skip to the conclusion, and then I will take the questions and maybe answer some. But the concluding thing is that organic crops contain larger amounts of magnesium and phosphorus. They have less toxic heavy metals. They have higher vitamin C, higher antioxidant activity, and of course, what we were saying, they need much more research. And I'm going to stop at this point and take the questions. Of course, I needed to acknowledge the Southeast Partnership, my colleagues, Mr. Bichui, my graduate students, but I will take it. If you have questions, I will take any questions. Yes, sir.
I know you're not on the production end of things, but what did the research say in terms of why organic produces so much iron compared to conventional produce?
Why organic?
Why is organic produce so much higher in nutrient content than conventionally produced produce?
For example, if we take antioxidants, for example, and I think somebody could help me out, one of the breeders or whatever. You talk about stress levels in the plant and they have to produce much more antioxidants because it has something to do with the stress level. So that's all your antioxidants, for example. Vitamin C is also an antioxidant, so that might be one reason. Again, the microbes in the soil create a kind of environment where they break down certain things, creating increase. increases in certain nutrients. Yes, sir?
New technology is able to measure the nutrient content in blood. And so now, next year we'd like to know how much nutrients are in people's blood that are on conventional diets and those that are on organic diets.
Okay, I think I have a slide. Let me show you. I have a slide that talked about diet intake, right? They looked at this slide. So they looked at an organic diet, right? And they, someone on a conventional diet. And when we measured, as you were saying, we measured vitamin C content, for example, that the person on the organic diet had one day, that was just one day's meal, 89.2 milligrams of vitamin C versus the person on the conventional diet who had roughly 68%. Similarly for iron, for magnesium, for phosphorus. So we are already doing that. We are already looking at it on our whole, the whole picture. Yes? I will take you after.
This might be kind of a silly question, but when you're measuring the difference between the diets of organic and natural, were they the same, or are you looking at like their differences when someone who's eating organic vegetables, like maybe they're more inclined to eat more, or like if those conventional areas, you know, maybe they don't care so much, so they're not eating so much?
Well, they would be the same, and they would have had to be consuming the diet over, but so, okay, you're not going to measure a 2,000 calorie diet against 1,800 calories or whatever. So you kind of make the conditions very much the same. They would have to be eating the diet over a certain number of times, same time. You try as much as possible to get the organic and the conventional grown, same place, that kind of, you try to control as much. And I have one.
Nate, has any research been done on the timing of when something is picked in the conventional system going into the changeable system? The produce is generally picked quite a bit earlier than, say, when I would pick my stuff that's going to the farmer's market. I can pick it when it's mature, carry it and sell it the next day, whereas conventional, it may be picked 3 weeks, as long as they got the color. Is there anybody, what about the nutritive value of that difference in time between when that's picked and when I pick it?
And those are some of the variations that I was talking about. That's, so when we do the research, when they do the research, we'd have to control those things. We'd have to ensure we can, for example, when we are doing this research, we don't go to the marketplace to get stuff because all those differences could arise. And that's why we are having so many problems, but we try to put conditions very much the same. Yes?
Have you ever looked at the differences between, say, organic soil grown strawberries and hydroponically grown produce?
Organic and hydroponic?
Yeah.
I haven't seen that, I haven't looked at that, but I'm sure it might be okay if it happens. But I haven't looked at organic. Would the hydroponic be organic too or what?
It could be, first thing I did with transitioning land was remineralize soils, and many farmers pay attention to trying to remineralize and add minerals to their soils.
Yeah,
by plants.
I haven't seen that that research, but I look for it now that I've been asked. I see a hand.
I don't know if you're familiar with Dan Kittredge and the Bio-Nutrient Food Association, but he is speaking to that issue of general depletion of minerals in all of our agricultural soils. And I'm wondering if you looked at any research about what the mineral content was
in these same vegetables 20 years ago, 30 years ago. An example that I read about was they looked at goldenrod in an arboretum, look at the pollen, and it has 30% less protein now than it had then. Also, what about the impact of more carbon dioxide in the air, and therefore more carbohydrates being produced?
Yeah, those are the variations we are talking about, which is making it really, really difficult. Thank you all very much.